My name is Sean, and I work at Caucho Technology. I do have with me Alexandra Garman. She's also a member of Caucho. And I'm here to talk about high availability within the Resin Java EE application server. So sort of to kick things off, start off, how many people here have heard about the Resin application server? And heard and used the Resin application server? Okay. All right, one first then. Small crowd. Okay, so we'll kick things off here with the overview of what Caucho Technology are, who we are, what is Resin. We'll look at Resin in the market. Why are people using it? Why aren't they using it? Resin features and some of the high availability monitoring that Resin has, and then also go over a couple of the Resin client cases. And when we talk about high availability at Caucho, really we're talking about two things. So one would be the ability to spin up more servers to answer requests, and then two would be the ability to actually recover from a server in live deployment that may go down. So combining the ability to answer more requests with recover when certain servers do go down is how our users are defining their four nines in terms of high availability. Okay. So Caucho Technology, just a brief overview of when who we are, when we got started. We actually got started in 98, so we actually pre-wrote our server container that predates Tomcat. So when Resin was originally wrote by Scott Ferguson, who still heads the development today, it was actually our only competitor out there was JRun. So throughout the years here, we have had Salesforce started on us as a startup, so I believe they were about a 5 or 6 person company when they launched on us. We deployed Hessian as a binary protocol. I'm not sure if anybody has used or heard of Hessian. Any Hessian users out there? No? Quarkus was a project that it's still in existence today. We still have OEM deals and partnerships with people who are using Quarkus. Quarkus is our PHP to Java integration, so it converts and compiles PHP code into Java to run on the server. So moving forward there, we've released Resin 4.0 in 2008. In 2012, we got a report from Netcraft that we had almost about 5 million sites deployed on Resin. Recently, with our partnership in NTT Data with Japan, we've had Toyota as well as Mitsubishi launch on Resin. So they're running a couple of large deployments with Resin, and 2017 just started, so no bullet points there yet. Okay, so what is Resin? The definition, caucho, the noun, is the resin that's derived from the Argentine caucho tree. So that would be our definition of where our name as a company comes from, as well as the software products. But in actual, what is Resin? Well, I decided to pull this quote here from Tech and Power. So Tech and Power, you guys familiar with their benchmarks that they run? They have a huge GitHub repository where they benchmark all the latest and greatest frameworks out there. Huge test suite that they're doing, and it's pretty reputable in terms of looking at JSON serialization. They look at some plain text, and I think they look at a database storage as well. So what's Resin? This was a question pulled on their site. Why aren't you using Tomcat for the Java frameworks? Well, this was their response. Resin's a Java app server. The GPL version, so we have two flavors of Resin. The GPL version is the one that they're using for our test, and they said that it's a relatively lightweight server container. They tested Tomcat as well, ultimately dropped Tomcat because Resin was slightly faster across the framework. So Resin GPL is our open source version of Resin. It's out there. We have tons of deployments who are using Resin open source and GPL in production. But we do have two flavors of Resin. So Resin Pro is the high availability section, and that's what we'll be talking about today. So what is Resin Continued? One picture smaller than the other, they're actually the same picture. Really, when you look at it, it's a all-in-one stack. So when I say an all-in-one stack, basically, Resin was the first actual Java EE web profile certified application server. And what we did there was we looked at really the JSRs that developers were really using out there and needed, and Scott Ferguson really made an ultimate decision of I'm going to implement these JSRs because this is what he saw as needed for running a Java web application. So before the sort of microservices buzzwords came about, Caucho was a bit paving the way with our Java EE Web Profile Certified Application Server. So the things that Resin does include is a software load balancer, has a proxy cache, has a web server as well. Resin JMS is not as popular as it used to be. A lot of people, there's a lot of messaging queues out there right now, ZeroMQ, RabbitMQ, that people do integrate with Resin instead of the JMS. Then we have the app server as well as the Resin cache. And then across the stack, we have integrated application monitoring management within Resin. So why did people choose to use Resin over a third-party cloud? Well, at every one of those integration points, you really are looking at integrating third-party modules. Some work well together with each other, others don't. But for us in our in-house development, we maintain a very high level of code fixes within our source code as well. So Resin's a very secure and tightly optimized package to work with each other. So let's look a little bit more at what the Resin stack actually is. So I talked about the smart load balancer, HTTP proxy cache, web server, app server, and distributed cache as well. And this is coming in 27 megabytes. So the actual memory footprint of Resin itself is very low. Doesn't seem to be a huge point for a lot of our deployments, but for our clusters of hundreds more of servers, it starts to get into the savings in terms of their hardware that they have to actually purchase. So looking at Resin in the market, bit of a longer definition, it's fast, ultra-reliable Java EE integrated solution. Scaling multiple third-party components can be difficult and expensive, depending on where you want to spend your time. We have built-in features, and really these built-in features are default features in Resin, right? So we have clustering that allows you to really scale up or scale down to match your load, whether that be a private cloud, a hybrid cloud, or something in Amazon EC2. We have distributed caching to reduce your reliance on traditional databases, so to reduce the bottlenecks within your application. We have adaptive health monitoring, and we'll get into a little bit more of what that means exactly. And then we have the last point here, that it's embeddable. So Resin as itself is deployed, and worldwide, I think over 5 million sites we have, but OEM'd, we have a lot more that we're not exactly sure how many people have it OEM'd inside of their actual product. So same way people use Jetty, embed Tomcat, you can embed Resin within your actual application itself. So just a couple of our success stories. So Aris, they use it as a gateway product. The actual company, the front-facing company, is Time Warner Cable and TalkTalk. They have something like a requirement that every device that was connected must receive a new IP address every 24 hours. So they're running this check through millions of end devices, and that's all running on Resin. We have the Similati group in Helsinki, Finland. Might need to check if they're still number one on demand. I'm not sure if Netflix has expanded there, but they were also using Resin to process 27 million invoices a month. Salesforce, so their Dreamforce conference that they hold every year runs on Resin. This past Dreamforce conference, they contacted us just for a couple of tips about configurations, but they had no issues in scaling up and down to meet all their end users and devices, so that was good to hear. A couple more success stories. We're used as a backbone for Copart, who does auctions across, so they do a couple hundred millions in sales, and they have a worldwide auction system of cars that they do. We have IHG, International Intercontinental Hotels and Group. And then a couple of here at the bottom, Toronto Stock Exchange, Patagonia, Samsung, Honda, and Toyota. And Honda, Samsung, Toyota, they come through our partnership with NTT. So NTT is pretty much the Amazon of Japan. And they have Bank of Japan. All the pretty much large companies are running in their cloud, and their cloud is powered by Resin. Okay, so why use Resin? It's really a question that people ask us quite a bit. There's a lot of different options out there, documented options out there. Why are people using Resin? I just decided I'd pull a couple of quotes because they can say it better than us. Though it rarely happens, whenever one of our domains goes down, Resin's watchdog monitor restarts it automatically. We've been using Resin for 5 years and achieved 99.99% uptime. It's very reliable and fast. They host several websites and particularly like the ability to run each domain in its own isolated Java virtual machine. We have another quote here from Brandon Cruz at GoHealth. They tried a lot and they like the advanced load balancing, high visibility website for their server performance. Resin performs well under that. And then the last quote here that we had, one from Brian McGuire, really, you know, gets back to the focus package of Resin. So when Resin, you know, when we started implementing the JSRs there, and actually Scott Ferguson, we have a couple of our engineers who are on the web, the protocols for different JSRs, like the website protocol. So we get our hands on the actual specifications a little bit early, and we have some high input in it, and it allows us to maintain Resin as really a focus package on what pieces we think are going to be relevant in the field for years to come. And it's proven successful because we still do have users who are deployed our Resin 2 and Resin 3 versions that came out in 2003 and 2004, and they're still working for them today. We're trying to get them upgraded, but that's another story. Okay, and then just the final point here of why using Resin. Well, it's really our bug fixes and our feature requests overall. So currently in the Resin, on our bug tracker, we have about 14 open bugs. I think four of them are feature requests, and the other 10 are just open issues currently. But the rate of how fast we do fix our bugs, and we're able to really provide good insight for a lot of the clients who do run on Resin. So our health monitoring capabilities within Resin really allows Resin to run itself. So the overall point of why people are using Resin as opposed to Tomcat or as opposed to Jetty is that Resin really runs itself. Whenever there is an actual issue within an application deployed on Resin, Resin is very good at tracking down what the actual cause, root cause of that issue is, restarting it, giving a PDF report detailing the memory usage, CPU usage, and we'll go over one of those reports a little bit later. But users, you know, moving from Tomcat, mainly just say, you know, we're restarting our Tomcat stack every day, every other day, every couple of hours, and with Resin, it's just been kind of running in the background since they installed it. So, how are we getting high availability? What are we doing, and what's going on within each component? Let's take a look a little bit deeper at some of these components. So, the Resin load balancer. The Resin load balancer is a software load balancer. It sits in front of our web server. It allows you to really just load balance based on three actual different types of use cases. So you can have a round robin load balancer, you can have a CPU based load balancer. The third one slips my mind right now. Our load balancer does support sticky sessions. It's a simple configuration. Again, we like to mainly put Resin out there in its download format that whether you're a senior developer or just getting started, you download and install Resin, and the setup that it gives you once you put in your IP addresses is going to be a highly available setup. So we try to make minimal configuration, although our documentation is pretty terse in terms of what we have listed there. So the software load balancer is included. Some people do use this injunction with like an F5 hardware load balancer just to do SSL offloading, things of this nature. One other thing I will mention while we're here is that Resin does work with Apache or IIS, so we do have a mod Caucho handle module that works with people who want to use their Apache web servers and then load balance to the back end Resin app servers here.
Are you using Tomcat? Is there a company using Tomcat? Is it easy to migrate or change your system to Resin?
Yeah, so it's fairly standard. The good news is that the JSRs all have to pass the TCK technology compatibility kit test, and so if your WAR file is running on Tomcat and you've coded to good standards, then ideally, in theory, you're able to just take that WAR file and dump it onto Resin with some small configuration changes. So, but yes, we have a lot of users who migrate over from Tomcat to Resin. We've also had a migration document for WebLogic. Any WebLogic WebSphere users still out there? No? We still have a WebLogic and WebSphere document that we migrated a couple of those users over to. And in all cases, there are, you know, some implementation details where the way we're handling our class loaders or JSP serve engine is a bit different. But it usually is something that is able to be mitigated through a couple of codes and line changes. So migration from Tomcat is very simple. Migration from GlassFish is very simple. Migration from WebLogic and WebSphere, you're going to get your hands a little bit dirty with some of the stuff.
Does the load balancer handle SSL at all, or do you need a developer appliance?
So we do OpenSSL. It integrates OpenSSL as well as JSSE. So either flavor if you'd like, but yeah, most people are using OpenSSL integrated with the load balancer.
Can you terminate it at the load balancer and send behind it the non-SSL, or does it have to go all the way to the Resin server test?
So no, you don't actually have to. You can terminate it if you like at the web server level, and what we do from there is when we pass the request on, we set a flag that Resin will treat this connection as though we're secure, but we're not actually, but after there it's effectively been terminated, correct. Okay, so our HTTP proxy cache, really, you know, not too much to say about it. Rather than store it in the database, stick it in the proxy cache, and you know, we tell a lot of our new users that if they're not using a proxy cache, they should be using a proxy cache. It's really for database heavy pages, but you know, nothing too special about our cache. We do have a hit miss ratio that a lot of people do tell us was useful in tracking down whether or not they thought the code of what they were doing was helpful to them or not. So some people, for instance, are deploying a cache, and then their cache hit-miss ratio is or the hit ratio is about 10%, and they're wondering what's going on. Some of that just has to do with how long they're leaving things in the cache, when it's getting invalidated, things of that nature. But the health system really helps track down, you know, is your cache even speeding up your application, or is it just eating up some more resources on your system? Okay, so our web server, you know, last time we benchmarked it, beat Nginx and Apache in terms of raw performance and throughput. It does do fast CGI, it's a fast CGI proxy, so it's compatible with native PHP, Python, Ruby, and more. A lot of people do use the URL rewrite rules, so sometimes we're surprised to see upwards of 100 to 200 rewrite rules going on within an application. We were surprised at how many, the level of depth to which it was being used, but you know, people report that they're not actually seeing any sorts of performance impacts with that, so that was good news for us to hear. Security. We talked about briefly integrated OpenSSL support. We do virtual hosting, so you can host multiple sites on one server, multiple JVMs if you'd like. That really wraps up the Resin Web Server. So again, Resin Web Server, it's written from scratch, so all in-house. The code is very maintained, and we like to keep the memory footprint small, so these are the main features within our web server itself. And the app server here, we'll just kind of go through. It's scalable, it's fast. We do have a command line as well as an admin console, JMX and REST interface, so any JMS metric is available within the system. It's fairly lightweight, small footprint. We did CDI before CDI was called context and dependency injection. But it's a really complete server, so it gives you web profile support, cache server messaging, and the cloud support really wraps up, you know, portions of the app server that we find people using quite a bit. Okay, and then the last piece of our actual in-house package would be our distributed cache. So we can do automatic data persistence. Triple redundancy is something that what we do is the way we've put out our default setup is we recommend users do a three server setup, and that would be a triad. So deploy your application to three servers. What happens then is the first three servers that your WAR file gets deployed to will maintain a copy of all the session data and share it across each other. It's all synchronized. Every other server that you spin up to join your cluster beyond that requires no configuration. It just spins up, it automatically joins the cluster, automatically starts receiving requests. The good news is that if ever you need to bring a server down for maintenance, or if ever you have a server run out of memory, somebody trip over a power cord, something like this, if you have redundant servers in the triad geographically dispersed, well, there's no downtime to your end users. This all kind of seamlessly shifts over in the background. It's not completely necessary to always have three servers. Some people do run two, but then of course they call us and they want to know, you know, we have a live deployment, we got a couple tens of thousands of users on, what are we going to do about the server? I'm like, well, the triad is our default setup, you know. So it's configurable. And we do have Memcached WAR protocol support. Okay. So our cloud, the Resin cloud, in terms of what it does and how it works. Well, I talked about it briefly, but the main focal point of our Resin clustering in general is that we feel that even if you are deploying one to one server, we're going to call it a cluster. And the reason why we do that is just to keep things simple as you expand your cluster. Because most people will, in QA or development, deploy to one server and then quickly realize that, we want to deploy to, you know, our investors liked it, they liked the model, we're going to Amazon EC2, we're going to hit 100 servers now. How will that affect our application? Well, the good news is within Resin, it's going to run pretty much the same in terms of the configuration and the setup that you already had. So there's not a big learning curve in terms of going from a small in-house deployment to a live deployment being served by hundreds of thousands of endpoints or devices. Resin cloud deployment. So one of the things that we do with cloud deployments for high availability is to keep things consistent based on an internal Git version control system. So when you automatically push your WAR file to one of the triad servers, it will get pushed over propagated to the other two servers within the cluster. And then after that, it's able to answer requests. You can spin up more of the elastic servers, as we call them, and they have the application running on them as well to participate. We do support version deployment. So version deployment is really if you have one version of a WAR file and you've made some minor tweaks and you want to, basically do A/B testing with your application. Well, you can deploy a new version of your application in conjunction with the current version that's running. And what's going to happen is the sessions that are connected to your older version, as soon as the request is finished done being processed, are propagated over to the new version of the application. And Resin's keeping track of the connections to that old application. Once all requests have been moved over to the new WAR deployment, then Resin goes ahead and does some cleanup, cleans up the last WAR file, cleans up the data directory as well. So the version deployment is something, there's a few requirements that have to be met, such as you can't really be changing your session data, because there's no way that we can, migrate our serialized sessions to a new server without, making some changes there. But it is something that users are using within Resin with a great level of success. So putting out different versions of applications, trying new things, trying new mobile selector pages, for example, all working well within the Resin application server. Okay. And deployment options. So deploying to Resin, you can use our command line. We have a web console Resin admin as well. We have a REST interface that you can interface with, or you can just drop Antesk off and have it be done as well. All right, so our cloud support. This picture really just kind of captures our thinking on, what Resin high availability and cloud support really is about. Here you see the triad servers, and the cluster is going to push all of its data and share that data within the three servers within a triad. Every server that you're seeing spun up off of here, okay, so this would be your load balance cluster and this is your application cluster. Every server that you're seeing spun up over here is what we call an elastic server. So those servers are really coming up depending on the time of the day. So for example, guilds.com is a website that they have flash sales at, I believe, noon or 1 or something like that. So their traffic sees a huge spike right along the noon period. Users and clients who are using Resin in that fashion where they have high loads coming in at a certain point of the day, they've actually got automatic scripts that spin up these servers for them, these elastic servers. They're spun up, they meet the traffic waves, and then they kind of slowly spin back down. So it works well for Amazon's EC2's pricing and really the pricing model of a lot of the cloud deployments out there. In our load balancer strategy, again, we have round robin, we do have the green adaptive, and then we have the CPU adaptive. Triad servers, again, mainly for the redundancy and maintaining the cluster state. Just as a question here, how many people are using persistent sessions, stateful applications you're working with? And everybody else is mainly stateless? Okay, so Resin high availability monitoring. So when Resin runs, there's actually two processes that are running. One's the actual Resin process itself, and the other is the watchdog process. The watchdog process is responsible for maintaining the Resin is up and alive, basically pinging it every now and then with a heartbeat connection, looking for you, are you still there, what's going on. Our high availability monitoring, this is an image pulled from the Resin admin console. What it gives you is, you know, restart diagnostics, garbage collection metrics, log messages, CPU usage and load, anomaly detection. So for instance, if you have certain odd behavior that goes on in your application, you're not sure why, well, we have a default anomaly detector. So once Resin has been running for a while, it's going to get a baseline of your stats on your server. And once it has its baseline, you can set the anomaly detector to say, well, if my memory, if my CPU load, or if my request time spikes to 40% above, you know, normal deviation there, I want to trigger a PDF report and I want to get statistics on my entire system so that I can know what's going on. And so this is a way that people use our anomaly detector to sort of sniff out potential errors before they happen. Because usually it doesn't take downtime in a live deployment. Usually there was some hints or clues beforehand that your application had some areas that needed to be addressed. Our anomaly detector is what does that addressing for us. And really, our PDF report and health report really was organically grown out of a need for us to support our end users. And I'll go into a case a little bit later. But just for instance, getting better insight from our end users about their application and their statistics led us to integrating our healthcare into the Resin application server, and in turn to really cut down on our support times as well. So it's sort of a win-win on both sides, because customers are getting more insight into their application, more comfortable with their deployments, and then on our side, we're getting the information we need to know in terms of where's the problem within your application if something went down. And then just another list of the things that we're doing there. So analyzing heap usage to understand the memory profile of an application. So that's something that people are doing with our PDF reports. You can probe the performance bottlenecks dynamically within a current application. You know, some people have emails sent to them, given an anomaly, or a pager that's sent to them. So it's all configurable that from their end, you know, we actually had a Resin 3 user migrate from Resin 3 to 4, and you know, we asked them what they were going to be doing when they finished their 4 upgrade, and he was actually taking a sailing trip around the world. And so the reason was that, you know, once he was confident that Resin 4 was going to be up and running, he could remotely manage his application and his stack from a boat. He was that confident. We never got any major request support, so I guess everything went well with that. So reviewing any critical messages, tuning in the cache settings, so that's something that we talked about as well, and then the automatic server restart when your server crashes. So again, most users who come from Tomcat and go into the Resin experience really tell us that, you know, they were spending 40 to 50% of their time maybe debugging their stack, managing their Tomcat instances, restarting them when it was slow, they weren't exactly sure. Our health system is not a replacement for Nagios, for example, okay? But it is, from our perspective, gives us enough insight to know where the critical portions of an application will be and what areas need to be addressed when there's something going wrong within an application. So just a small sort of image here, it's a little bit blurry, of one of the menus you can pull up from the admin page. So on the admin page itself, I'm actually just looking at the Resin Admin app. So the Resin Admin is actually, it's a PHP app, comes bundled within Resin itself and uses our Quarkus interpreter to run. Can give you things such as the session state, session size, how many requests are going on within your application, how many requests are active, and we'll look a little bit more at some of the more detailed report a bit later, but keep track of those things for you. And really just, you know, gives you a little bit more confidence in terms of your application, in terms of what's going on and pertinent information that you might want to know. Any JMX metric is actually available to be looked at on this Resin Admin page. Okay. So the watchdog process, I did talk a bit about it earlier. Really, it's one of the features that can be run separately. So you can run the Resin instance by itself. We have had a couple of requests for embedded reasoning to do so. But really, we recommend keeping it running because it's just going to automatically restart your server if it goes down. So sometimes, you know, we have clients say, oh, they just email us our PDF report because they say, oh, last night, 1 a.m., our server restarted. We didn't really know. We didn't see any major impacts to our clients. But we have this PDF report in our inbox that told us, you know, something restarted last night. And so then we go through probing it, and usually we find an issue, area within their application of why your app server restarted or your web server restarted, JVM ran out of memory, those sort of things. We just call it really the non-stop mode in Resin. So non-stop mode is powered by the Resin watchdog process, and again, it's a separate process that's constantly monitoring the state of your servers. So it's an added level of benefit that it's going to restart the server for you if it goes down.
Is the watchdog process smart enough to talk to the load balancer to say pull it before it restarts it?
Not currently. So. Yeah, so feature request, you know, we only got about 11. Not currently, it doesn't do that. It's just monitoring the job process itself, but, you know, potentially it could be something that we do expand upon. Cool. So health checks in action, so we talked a bit about this. again, the health system is really, didn't realize these pictures are a little blurry. I can read them better here for you. So some of the things that you can look at within your health monitoring capabilities are such as the CPU health, obviously, of your servers. The Resin health check is going to be a check that, for example, aggregates all of your other checks together, so you can define your own sort of health checks, right? And the way you actually define your own health checks are a combination of some of these dump heap, dump threads, execute command, or restart or send mail. So you can define your own sort of metrics within your system that you think are pertinent and you want to pay attention to. You can trigger actions based upon those JMX metrics, based upon requests, time. It's really kind of all over the place, some of the defined custom health checks that we're seeing people monitor within their application. But what it's giving to them is the ability to, you know, sail around the world confidently that your application is not going to restart and you'll be pulling down the sail trying to get back. So health checks and actions that we have defined right now, And this is all in our documentation as well, with the clear images if you want to take a look. Okay. And so one example of this actions based on condition. So what we're seeing here is actions can be grouped. So we have a health action sequence start. And what we're saying is if the health is in a critical state for 2 minutes, we want to go ahead and perform a set of actions and checks. We have a fail-safe restart because you know, when your server is experiencing low memory or spikes in 3PUs, spikes in your thread usage, these sort of things, it's not guaranteed that all of these commands can be run. So we have a fail-safe restart that says if 10 minutes into the gathering statistics, you're not able to gather statistics, just go ahead and restart, get the server back up, because that's what's more important. We can do the prognosis after the fact, but we rather would not want to sit here for longer than 10 minutes with the down server. And then just a couple of things that we want to look at, JMX threads and the heap. Usually a good indicator as to what was going on when the system restarted, and then a profiler as well if you'd like to profile your CPU. So that is really the Resin package in terms of what we're doing, what we're providing, and what people are using within Resin. And when we look at it and we talk about Resin high availability, you know, the top three, I guess, features people are looking at beyond the default setup would be version deployment, removing live servers for maintenance, and the automatic health action restarts. So the health system, you know, now that I'm thinking of this, I'm not sure why, but you can disable the health system. So occasionally we have people who will say, hey, we're having some issues with our servers restarting, availability time doesn't seem to be up. What's going on? And we ask them, okay, hey, well, there should be a log folder, and there'll be some PDF reports, printouts, and they'll, you know, have some good information that we can look at. And they say, oh, well, we disabled our health system. And it's a bit of, well, you know, how do you expect us to get this information? Good news is that you can usually just enable it with one line configuration. If the problem's still there, it's you know, going to come back up. We can increase the level of logging, you know, quite dramatically to really get a handle on every request going through the system and its stack trace at every single level of the classes it was hitting. So usually that level of logging is not necessary. It's a bit, you know, much the class logging at the fine level for us. So there's fine, finest. And usually fine is the one that we recommend with getting insight as to what was going on in the system. Okay, so actually from here, I do have our client case coming up. So it looks like it's 7:50. Did we want a break now? Or
sure. Let's go ahead and take a 5 or 10 minute break. Restrooms are just straight down the hall. More pizza up here.